Rejoice ye Sony faithful, for the PSVR 2 has arrived, and Sony's even done the hard work of tearing this thing down for us. This is Sony's second foray into the VR market, and the industry has come leaps and bounds since then. Even from the outside, we can see some interesting changes. The single element lenses from the last model have been replaced with Fresnel lenses, definitely a step up, but still bulkier than the latest and greatest pancake lenses like those in the MetaQuest Pro. But here's the thing, their decision to use Fresnel lenses is part of a larger compromise that's helping Sony avoid the $1,100 to $1,500 price tags we're seeing on some of the newer headsets. In a nutshell, that's what this VR headset is, a balance between old and affordable, and new and expensive. What I'd like to know is, can I fix this $550 compromise if it breaks? Let's take a look at it from the inside out. Separating the front end from the headband is as simple as removing a cable and pressing down on this hidden lever. Too easy. And with the front separated, it's time to remove the light blockers. So far, I haven't even had to use any tools yet. Alright, now I need to get a few screws out so we can remove some of the plastic. It's at this point that I get some really strong Quest 2 vibes off this headset. The layout seems familiar, yet less cluttered. If only the Quest 2 was half this easy to disassemble. Case in point, the bottom camera is held down by two screws, a couple of ribbon cable connectors, and comes away as a single module. Compare this to the Quest 2 or Quest Pro's garish mix of ribbon cables covered in thermal paste. Sony even explains in their video how they used rubber grommets to avoid having to glue parts down, which is music to my ears. The upper cameras are secured by a couple screws and a ribbon cable and come away individually. The integrated tracking cameras on the PSVR 2 are new to Sony's VR line, replacing the external tracking camera used with the original PSVR. Just a few screws and I can remove the fan, vent, and this module holding the microphone. With the main board out, I can take a peek under the heatsink to get our first look at the IC running the show, and it looks like a PS5 Southbridge IC. We'll have a detailed chip ID on our blog soon, so be sure to check back if you want to find out what else is on this PCB. You'll notice how uncomplicated this board looks relative to the Quest Pro. That's because the PSVR 2 is a tethered headset. The obvious benefit of that design decision is that it's cheaper to produce, but the downside is that you'll always be leashed to a PS5. I need to remove a couple more bits of plastic here to get my first look at the display panels. That IPD adjustment knob is next, and removing it gives us access to the horizontal bar that the screens slide on. Onto the meat and potatoes of this teardown, the Fresnel lenses and tapered panels. Getting the optical assembly out just needs a little flexing of the plastic, and out they come. Comparing the PSVR 2 and Quest Pro lenses clearly shows the space-saving benefits of pancake lenses. But don't be fooled into thinking one is better than the other. Each technology has trade-offs. Pancake lenses like these come at a cost because they need brighter panels that operate at higher resolutions. Now, the specifics of that are beyond the scope of this video, but if you'd like to know more, check out Carl Gutag or Brad Lynch's blogs for a deeper analysis. But suffice it to say that the LCD panels used in the Quest Pro perform similarly to the panels in the Quest 2, despite costing more. So what would a high-end solution look like? Well, it's going to be a combination of high-resolution micro OLED panels, something that's not present in current generation headsets, together with pancake lenses. That's what it's going to take to reduce the screen door effect in OLED panels like these, while addressing the size, weight, and contrast constraints of LCD panels like these. It's worth bearing in mind when you see next generation headsets coming in at $3,000 and above, because this technology really is that expensive. With the PSVR 2, Sony has chosen nominal resolution and high contrast OLED screens to compensate for cheaper Fresnel lenses. The 2000 by 2040 pixel per eye is already a huge upgrade over the PSVR's 960 by 1080 panel, but thanks to the excellent OLED contrast, you have a truly stunning visual experience. Tethering the headset, as opposed to providing it with a dedicated system on chip, helps further reduce the build complexity, the result of which is a headset that is well below $1,000, but can still deliver a stunning visual experience. And that's the compromise, a balance of color quality, manufacturing cost, visual clarity, and freedom of movement. Now, the eye tracking is the same style as the Quest Pro, a series of infrared LED emitters all placed around the edge of the lens with a single infrared camera offset on the side to collect the light that bounces back. It's a fun technology that's made its way into most newer headsets, but I'm delighted to see that Sony has managed to completely avoid adhesive. MetaQuest Pro, take note. On the headband, it's nice to see easily detachable cushions that'll make cleaning and replacing a cinch. This should be standard on every component that makes contact with skin. Now, here's something pretty cool that separates PSVR 2 from all other mainstream VR headsets. haptic feedback inside the headset. It's just a simple rumble motor, but Sony is clearly after immersion. Time to get good, gamers. Headshots are about to suck a lot more. Now let's see how Sony's PSVR2 Sense controller measures up to the competition. My goal here is to look at battery replacements and maybe check out the thumbstick and adaptive trigger. We've got the familiar tracking ring, which is decked out with infrared LEDs all the way around. All screws and no glue makes me a happy fixer. Valve Index, take note. That said, Sony's teardown made removing the tracking ring look a little too easy. It's pretty difficult, but definitely possible. Unlike lighthouse-style tracking, what's called outside-in tracking, the headset itself reads these infrared LEDs to figure out which way you're looking. This style of tracking is called inside-out tracking, and you guessed it, it's another compromise between accuracy and cost, and maybe even convenience. Who wants yet another box to mount on a wall? We break things so you don't have to, and a bit of the plastic housing is our first casualty on the way to the battery. Let's take a look at that 520mAh battery. This tiny, accessible bundle of energy can last about 3 hours according to reviewers. Not bad at all. Sony glazed over this next bit, and it's not hard to see why. Getting the triggers and thumbsticks is not only fiddly, but these sticks aren't hall sensor based, which means they're prone to drift. Go check out our stick drift videos if you want to know more about why stick drift occurs, and how manufacturers can permanently fix the issue. Let's have a look at those adaptive triggers. It's a modified version of the DualSense adaptive trigger, but it works in the same way. So there you have it, a truly great VR experience, and a pretty comfortable teardown experience too. This device does seem to have been designed with repairability in mind. From the thoughtful use of clips and rubber standoffs instead of glue, to a deliberate controller design with a relatively easy battery replacement, a hearty well done to the teams involved. We hope to see Sony follow through and support their engineering team's fantastically accessible design by offering spare parts and manuals to the general public. As for me, I'm gonna see if I can put this thing back together and see what worlds I can visit.